Hello everyone. If you've ever played around with the 6502 microprocessor found in a ton of old computers like the ones from Atari, Commodore, Apple, and Nintendo, you might have heard that you absolutely must get the CMOS version that came out in the 1980s because the original 6502 from 1975 can't be run one cycle at a time, making debugging harder. I'm happy to tell you that you've been misled, and it's not only possible to single cycle the original 6502, it's an intentionally built-in feature with its own dedicated pin. The confusion on the matter stems from the fact that the 6502 has dynamic registers and the newer 6502 is a fully static design. That means the 6502 won't lose the contents of its registers if you stop the clock, whereas the original 6502 will if you run it slower than about 10 kHz. Does that mean you can't run it one cycle at a time? As you might have guessed already, no it doesn't. It was only a few months after the 6502 was released by NMOS Technology at the end of 1975 that a little known company at the time was ready to release its first 6502 computer. And if we take a look at the manual for that computer, we'll see that Steve Wozniak thought single cycling the processor was important enough to include instructions in the manual on exactly how to do that. And all it took was a single extra IC, a 7474, a dual flip-flop. The circuit takes advantage of two 6502 pins, ready on pin 2 and sync on pin 7, on a 40-pin DIP package. The sync pin goes high whenever the processor is fetching an instruction and the ready pin halts the processor on read cycles. Combine those two and it's easy to see exactly what the processor is doing. If you try to set it up like Woz did, you'll start out being a little bit disappointed it doesn't work. So to get it to work, I've given it a bit of a modern refresh. You see, in 1976, you'd most likely be using TTL ICs, which inherently didn't need as many pull-up resistors since unused inputs would default to the high state. Whereas modern CMOS inputs need a defined state with at least a pull-up. So in the circuit Woz made, he simply left out the unused inputs in the schematic and assumed nothing would float. Since it's hard to get hold of logic ICs that antique, we need to update the schematic a bit by putting pull-up resistors on most of the inputs. Other than that, I had to take a good long look in the junk drawer to find some appropriate switches. The way the circuit works is that by default, the ready pin is low, halting the CPU with the address lines reflecting the currently fetched instruction or operand. That when the step button is pressed, the inverted Q of the left flip-flop, which is high at rest, is connected to the D input of the right flip-flop, making the output pull the ready pin high when the clock goes high. At the same time, the inverted Q of the right flip-flop goes low and sets the left flip-flop, making the ready pin go low again immediately on the next rising edge of the clock if the second button is set as single cycle mode. And if it's in single instruction mode, it doesn't go low until fetching the next instruction where sync is high. That way, the ready pin is only high for either a single cycle or a single instruction. And if we want the 6502 to run all the time, we flip the third switch that keeps the right flip-flop set. But of course, that's all theoretical, so let's try controlling a real NMOS 6502 with it. It's been a while since I had my full-size ABN 6502 single-board computer R1 on camera, since I've been focused on my 6502ino and programmer for a while. But it's super convenient for this test since it has both buses and all the control signals broken out, making it a breeze to hook up LEDs to the data bus. But of course, the idea behind the circuit is that it can easily be hooked up to any 6502, no matter if it's on a breadboard or inside a Commodore 64. To be able to see what we're doing, I'm just hooking up 8 LEDs to the data bus. Since they're hooked up straight to the data bus with no buffering, I want to limit the current as much as possible, but since the bus is also used for video half the time, which is mostly zeros, I go with 1500 ohms. That also means it'll look like the LEDs don't turn off completely when it seems they should, but actually they're just blinking 2 million times a second. With the LEDs ready, I plug in the star of today's show, a 74HC74 dual flip-flop. Then I hook up the power rails and remember a decoupling cap and then put in the pull-up resistors. I managed to find 3 double-pole double-throw switches where I just use one side. From the factory, they all latch when pressed, but I took apart the first one and removed the latch pin so I don't have to double press to release the step button. Since the switch pins don't fit in a breadboard, I've soldered on some lead confetti from old parts and it seems to work well enough. Hooking up the rest is a simple matter of following the schematic. Except these buttons happen to have a funny pinout with pin 1 and 3 connected at rest and 2 and 3 when locked. I've put LEDs on the sync signal so we can see if the CPU is fetching an instruction or operand. The ready light is really just an indicator for whether the CPU is running. And with all the wires in place, let's see if it actually does anything by hooking up the ready signal, the sync signal, and the clock. Another reason you might be confused why the circuit was made doesn't work for you is that he used the Phi-1 clock coming out of the 6502, but most modern circuits will just call the inverted input clock Phi-1. But actually, an inverted Phi-0 arrives sooner than a Phi-1 coming out of the NMOS 6502 would, which means the timing doesn't work for inspecting instructions, since it'll actually halt on the clock after the sync pulse. Luckily, we can still get it to halt at the next instruction if we just use the input clock, Phi-0, instead. For that reason, I've renamed the pin to clock, and you can try out both ways of running the circuit. If you only use single cycle mode, it doesn't really matter. With that in place, I believe we are ready to try it out and see if we can read some 6502 instructions. And it looks like that's no problem at all. We can take a look at what exactly we're reading here a bit later, but for now, I'm super excited that even though the CPU is running at 2 MHz, we're successfully halting it after each instruction so we can see what's on the data bus and inspect it before moving on to the next one. If we hooked up LEDs to the address bus, we could also see where the CPU is fetching the instructions from, but we don't really need to, since after a reset, we can easily deduce what the program counter should be at. If we jump to unused address space, I bet we could even feed the 6502 instructions on the fly. So maybe we can take a look at that in a future video. For now though, we still have a few things to try out in this video. But of course, lugging around a breadboard like this is a bit inconvenient if you want to hook it up to an Apple I or a Commodore 64 for that matter. So I decided to take it a bit further, and through the power of editing, I now have a box full of pre-assembled PCBs ready to single cycle some 6502s. A big thanks to JLC PCB for letting me do these projects. I have used them for years, and ordering is always a breeze. Since this project is completely open source, you can grab the Gerber files on GitHub, link in the description, and upload them to JLC PCB in just a few seconds. You can order PCBs super cheap and even have them professionally manufactured in just a few days. For this particular board, I took the chance and selected some buttons I haven't used before and picked a non-latching one for the step button and latching ones for the run and instruction cycle button. So let's hope they work according to the datasheet. I really appreciate having these boards made in just a few days and completely skip the delicate soldering, but still getting compact boards with SMD parts. I usually leave out having the pin header soldered to get them even cheaper, and that also leaves me with the choice of which type to put on and which side for that matter. For this one, I put 90 degree headers so it naturally points away from the board, but of course I could have put straight headers on the bottom side and plugged it into the breadboard instead. It's always super scary to go straight from design to manufactured boards, but for my last few projects, I've been lucky that the boards worked, even though I hadn't tried out the parts before. So let's hope I didn't jinx it by putting these boards straight to manufacture. Let's see if they work. I'm using my full-size computer because it conveniently has the signals broken out, but with a compact board like this, I imagine it's pretty easy to hook up to any old 6502 computer using test probes. By the look of the ready light and the data bus, it looks like the CPU is still running, but if we unlock the run switch, it should halt. And it works! At least we can run and halt the CPU, and it looks like stepping works too. It also looks like the cycle instruction switch in the middle works, and we can step through instructions only, or also check what's going on when the CPU is fetching operands. Let's try a reset and see what the next instruction is. Right now we're in single instruction mode, so we only see the instructions without the operands and wait cycles. 48 is push accumulator, so I don't know why that showed up after a reset, but the next instructions certainly look like they are part of the reset sequence. And eventually we enter a loop to clear the 0-page RAM, which is not the most interesting code to disassemble. Now, if we switch to single cycle mode instead of single instruction mode, we can probably also see more of the reset cycle. And it does indeed seem to respect the ready signal during reset, as what we see on the data bus is neither instructions or operands, but eventually we should see 0080, which is the address of the reset vector in little endian format. And then we can start going through the program code. The code we see here is pretty boring, as it's just common 6502 initialization code. Since the CPU might start in decimal mode, I always start by clearing it, and since I want to make sure interrupts are disabled, that's the next instruction. I've heard some people say they skip clearing 0-page and stack on reset because you should never rely on uninitialized data, but all other things equal, I do like to make sure a reset actually does a reset. So I do start out by clearing the first few pages of RAM where configuration and buffers are stored. Since I got more of these boards than I know what to do with, I've put them for sale on my store for a symbolic 5 euros plus shipping. You'll find a link to my store in the description, but also a link to my GitHub in case you want to take a look at the BOM or play around with the design and have it made. This is a cool little gadget that makes it easier to play around with 6502s on breadboards or inside a Commodore 64, not just the NMOS 6502s, but the 6502s too, of course. It really is so much fun to play around with the chips that powered the computers of my childhood. I remember taking apart enough old ghetto blasters to give my parents a headache, even though the green boards with sharp things sticking out of them seemed like absolute black magic. I still couldn't help at least trying to learn something about how they worked. Now, thanks to the internet and an amazing retro computing community, I get to learn all that black magic of my childhood, and maybe these videos will give someone out there the head start I would have loved to get myself. I really never thought I would ever figure out how the computers of my childhood worked, but here we are, and I'm actually making some of those green boards that seemed like the dark arts when I was a kid. So cool. And even cooler that people actually want to buy some of the kits I make. But honestly, most of the time what drives me is just nostalgia and happy memories of making a bicycle lamp light up on a piece of wood hooked up with nothing but nails and steel wire to a 4.5-volt lantern battery. Of course, I'm probably never going to be able to quit my day job from selling these kits, but I certainly don't mind putting in the time it takes to pack up and ship a few boards if it means getting some tech into the hands of people who enjoy getting a new kit in the mail. It's a lot of fun making things out in the open, and if you take a look at my hackaday.io page, you'll see most of the things I make end up out in the open eventually, even the not-so-polished projects. And as you can imagine, I don't plan to stop here. I also have a plan to make something bigger and more exciting in the future. If you can guess what this little single cycling board is a step on the way to, please leave a comment. And if you can't wait to hear more about what I have planned, you're super welcome to join my little retro computing hackerspace clubhouse on Discord. I love it when people share what they're working on, and I absolutely don't mind helping with other people's projects when I have the time. If you're new to this channel, thank you so much for sticking around this far, and I'm sure you'd like to check out my 65 Arduino or my relatively universal ROM programmer. Both are projects you can build yourself on a breadboard or buy kits to build on my store. So please check them out too. Either way, thanks for watching.